Hi, this is Jack Trimpey. Now that we've solved the problem of addiction recovery, we are now undertaking to help America recover from the social manifestation of addiction, the addiction treatment industry itself. To follow is a Substance Abuse Advisory Board meeting held in San Francisco during July 2002. This may sound like a big yawn, but you will soon see that when rational recovery comes up in public policy meetings, sparks fly. I want to thank Brian Haley for making my appearance possible, and I also thank all who were present at this meeting for asking good questions and challenging my challenges to public policies. I will propose here an escape hatch for the untreatables, those who obviously will not benefit from further addiction treatment. This escape hatch would be a small office where the hopeless ones might be socially vindicated and provided information on AVRT-based recovery. You will shortly witness the addiction treatment industry in all its splendor, resisting any attempt to release the untreatable so they might undertake self-recovery through planned permanent abstinence. If you want to do something to help in your community, the opt-out initiative is a potent proposal. This video is an excellent orientation to the obstacles and specific tactics which will be used to suppress any genuine alternative to prevailing practices. Finally, I thank the street people for their sincere remarks. For them, this production may become their memorial and a tribute to the many lives destroyed by the social manifestation of addiction, the addiction treatment industry.
We have quite a very nice group of members of the public with us today. Welcome. And we are, of course, being filmed today, which is a new thing. Would you like to explain why it's being done and
sure.
The people who are doing it?
Rational Recovery Systems is documenting much of their work as they're pioneering into the future, this new approach to addiction recovery, not only on the street, their interviews being taken. Something like this is a viable tool that they can use in developing future materials or, you know, tools that would reflect, you know, your interests and your wisdom, because without it, you know, how can actually AVRT, which is the backbone of rational recovery, have come about if it wasn't for the experience of formerly or currently addicted people, especially the folks that work in the field. It's a vital piece to the project.
What I'd like to do is introduce Mr. Jack Trimpey.
Thank you very much.
Please come on up.
I don't know if all of you or any of you are very familiar with rational recovery. Our time is limited here today, so I can't go too far into detail about our origins, our background, and so forth. But I can summarize and just simply say that we've been around since about 1985, that we have been pioneering avenues for addicted people, and that we're very interested in public policy, and that's why we're here. We know that public policy affects addicted people in a very direct and profound way, and we're interested in getting some of our perceptions of the nature of addiction and the nature of recovery to public policy bodies like this, so that we can possibly bring about some changes that would add to the options that are available to addicted people. We're looking at a number of California communities to see what happens when people are, they go through the system over and over and over again. They're the frequent flyers that I'm sure that you're all familiar with, because they come back so often. They keep coming back, just like the old saying says. And we have a hunch, in fact, it's, we think it's more than a hunch based on our experience, that some of those people are, you know, who keep coming back
might do better on their own than with the services that are available to them, specifically recovery groups and addiction treatment. We're very interested in the history of research in the addictions field that keeps showing very consistently that there is a group of people who have big time problems with alcohol and drugs and who get better on their own devices, in other words, on their own independently, and very often in spite of the exposure they've had to recovery groups and addiction treatment services. That's a very interesting population because we think that they know something. They know something that is really crucially important, and something has happened, we think, that in the addictions field that we have minimized the importance of what these self-recovered people know. So we've taken the trouble of going to them and kind of sweeping together their wisdom on how they have recovered from addictions, and we've created a lore of self-recovery in a very brief, easily learned educational format that we call AVRT. That stands for Addictive Voice Recognition Technique. And if you ever want to hear an account of AVRT, ask someone that you know who did quit drinking or drugging or smoking or something and say, how did you do that? How'd you do it? You say that you were on crack or heroin or alcohol, and now you have a family and a job, and you quit the stuff, and how did you do it? And what you'll probably hear is an account of self-recovery that is very close to what we have profiled in this AVRT. What we're interested in is getting this information on self-recovery into the addiction service system so that it becomes a real option for people to take 100% personal responsibility to abstain from alcohol and other drugs, not one day at a time, which is a time-honored way of doing it, but once for all time. I will never, ever do that again. And I can say that confidently because I know how to do it. Now I know what I'm dealing with. I'm sufficiently informed that I can confidently say to my social worker, my judge, the landlord in my housing place that I will never drink again. This is my word of honor. That's all we really have in this society after all said and done. And because I've taken the responsibility for lifetime abstinence, I would expect in return that my word of honor would be respected and that I wouldn't be discriminated against for matters of employment, housing, and other privileges that are essential to independent living in our society. So that's kind of a very brief kind of summary of what we're about, what we hope for, and what our purpose is here in San Francisco. I welcome discussion, questions, or whatever commentary you have, but we're proposing that San Francisco, among the many agencies that are here, and we don't really, at least I don't have much of an interest in which agencies would pick up on this activity, but to create an actual unit, a screening and case management unit that would identify the frequent flyers, these recidivists, who may be able to say, I do not go to recovery groups, and no, I don't want to go to addiction treatment services because, not just because I don't want to do it, but because it is operating at cross purposes to my own recovery plan, which is a self-inspired, inner-directed abstinence, which is quite different than the recovery group addiction treatment model, which has a lot to do with external factors in people's plan for abstinence. So that's the long and the short of it. We hope to see an office or a unit or an agency or something to come together that would serve the interests of people who wanted to recover independently from the traditional treatment and recovery group services. Yes, over here.
I work with a group of addiction recovery groups that use chiropractic, and we find that it works, I hate to say this out loud in public, but it's somewhere from 90 to 100% recovery rate.
Mm-hmm.
If people stay in recovery if they get chiropractic. The self-recovery groups work if the people have access to resources like ear acupuncture, like chiropractic. And I work dually both in the jails and out in public places.
And your question is what?
It's have you ever heard of using chiropractic? Do you have a chiropractor?
The approach that we recommend does not rely upon a spectrum of other services, professional, medical, or whatever. It's simply a person, as a matter of free will, deciding I will not use alcohol and drugs. It's kind of a strange alien idea these days that people have this inner resource to draw upon. And involves the pronoun I. We're very interested in the pronoun I because that seems to be the command symbol for moving hands and feet. I, in other words, I, the owner of the hands, will never do this again. And then making a commitment that is, if anything, sacred, that would be. It would become a fundamental element of a person's identity. I'm a person who never does that. I just don't do that. For me, it's wrong to do that. So it's much simpler than the models that we usually think of in terms of addiction recovery, where acupuncture and nutritional therapies and chiropractics and medical and 12-step and this whole cognitive behavioral stuff and all that. We have all those cards to play, but we keep hearing at our office, and we've had an office open to the public for 15 years now. We've had hundreds of thousands of contacts, all from people who have been through the system. And they are unhappy campers. A lot of them are frequent flyers. And they hear about rational recovery somehow, always indirectly, rarely, if ever, from a public agency. And they often go to the websites and have their suspicions confirmed in print, right before their eyes, that this isn't good for everybody. It might be good for some, but it's not good to congregate after dark with substance abusers. It's just not a good idea to do that, whether they're calling themselves a recovery group or not. So we want to be able to split off people. Now, a lot of people do very well in the recovery group milieu. Other people, it's like they're of a different species almost, and they get into a group and they aren't at home. They are more prone to take personal, individual responsibility than to shift the
even if that means
the idea of support. They don't need or want or even benefit from support.
20 different treatment programs.
Yeah.
Oh, probably about 50.
50. This guy was through 20 times. He's been through 50 times.
5, 6, 7 times. I gave up. I feel like life's over.
So you've been to treatment. You are a member of 12 Steps.
Yeah.
Did they ever explain to you how people actually recover from addictions?
You don't recover from it. It's a constant struggle every day, you know.
So you're struggling and ready to leave your addiction behind you?
Yes, I am. But it is sometimes overpowering.
There's a profound discouragement that goes on with these frequent flyers. They go around the track again and again. Here we are at a square one again, and around the track and back to square one. Pretty soon, they become profoundly discouraged that they can ever live a life that is self-determined, non-addicted. They think there's something wrong with them. They can't understand the 12-step program.
Feeling like some kind of a genetically defective person, which is what AA says you are, by the way.
Right,
you
okay.
are genetically genetically defective somehow. Like you're different from all other human beings. And that you are powerless and you're diseased and not to be trusted, and you know all that stuff.
Right.
So we're trying to give people a way to step out of the situation, because that can get in your way when you're trying to get a job and get on with your life.
We help to correct that perception that there's nothing wrong with you, that you would not understand that, that there's maybe something, this is a strength that we can build on, your natural skepticism, or perhaps your religious beliefs that contradict it, and we can build instead of attempting to call this all denial or something worse.
You had a question?
Yes, Santana, board member. I have a few questions. Who came up with this? Who started this?
Oh, I'm the founder of Rational Recovery.
You're the founder?
Mm-hmm.
And how long has this been around?
About 1985 or 6 was the gelling time.
Because okay. I've heard a little about it.
Yeah.
I'm curious as to, statistics, success rate, percentage-wise, and maybe I'm just from old school, but I'm not saying that this doesn't work for some people, but I teach my clients what may work for this person may not necessarily work for that person, and so I'm sure this works for some folks, but I've been in the substance abuse field for 9 years now, and I've yet to see anyone do it this way. I'll be very honest and very frank about that. I'm not trying to say that it doesn't work for some folks.
Well, in a way it does. I would think that what you're implying is that it wouldn't be very useful to very many people.
Mm-hmm.
And this is exactly the opposite perception that we get.
Yeah.
We hear from many, many people and watch and see and...
Because mm-hmm. I have many clients that say, this is the last time, Dinette, well, you're not going to see me anymore. This
right.
is the last time.
Now, here's
sure
the problem.
And I'm sure that they're sincere.
Let me say
finish
something
what I
here
want
now.
To say.
Okay.
And I'm sure that, you know, I'm for you, and if you want to change, I got, you know, a lot of services for you, and all the support you need and stuff, but it's easier said than done. And the
yeah.
majority of the people that relapse, in my experience in being in this field for 9 years, is two main reasons. One, they don't have a strong support system, and two, relationships.
Yeah.
And like I said, maybe I'm just from old school, but I'm really curious about this.
Okay, let me try to satisfy some of your curiosity here. The system that we put the people in reflects the values that you have just expressed, that you're really not going to be able to make it. And we can say, yeah, we believe in you, but there's still this overreaching idea that we are diseased, powerless, we need support, and all these things, and without it, you'll drink again. You have to do this, you have to deal with issues, or you'll drink again. You have to have support, or you'll drink again. You have to get a sponsor, or you'll drink again.
Yeah.
We keep hearing this message, you'll drink again, you'll drink again. I heard it when I was in AA. Every time I went there, get a sponsor, or you'll drink again. Keep coming back, or you'll drink again. Turn it over, all these things, or you'll drink again.
AA has never worked for me.
I know. It doesn't. We don't think that it works for anybody. What did you learn in all your treatment programs and all those groups?
They're bullshit.
AA meetings, you hear too much of people's downfalls, and it actually depresses you more than does anything.
What do they tell you in those groups?
If you don't succeed, just try, come back again, you know?
Keep coming back.
That I have no control.
Over the desire to get high. Tell you that you're powerless.
Oh yeah, over my addiction and.
What does that mean, powerless over your addiction?
That I have no control.
Over the desire to get high.
Yeah.
That sounds like about the worst thing to believe. If you're powerless over the desire to get high, where are you? As long as you think there are moments where you become powerless, then that's the illusion of addiction, we think. That there is no powerless. We're always in control every second.
All these things, or you'll drink again.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a part of me that's alive today inside of me, and it hears that, and it goes, oh yeah, I'm going to drink again. Hey, let's break out the booze. That's a part of me. I haven't had anything in 15 years, and I never will. But it's the memory of past pleasure that I'm a big, healthy guy, and I have a memory of my drunken episodes that were tragic in one way, but a whole lot of fun in another way. And there's the old animal part of me that still remembers the call of the wild. And when I hear people talking about all their miseries from addiction, it calls back the pleasures of addiction as well.
Are you going to go to recovery meetings?
I'm going to one or two.
What's the purpose in going there?
Reminding you of where you've been.
Kind of like rubbing the dog's nose in the shit, you mean?
Yeah.
Help you remember how awful it is?
Yeah.
A lot of times when you start thinking back about how bad it felt, you also remember how good it felt. Telling these old war stories about rolling around in the gutter.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden you remember, yeah, I was high as a kite down there and it felt pretty good from head to toe.
Yeah.
Sometimes you come out of there feeling like you want to use because you heard so much.
You walk out of those meetings, and that's when you really want to use. So what we think is that people ought to stay home at night, not be hanging out with other substance abusers after dark.
So for some people, it's better to allow these past experiences, this addiction, to fade into the past and become a person who simply never drinks as a matter of principle, rather than as the outcome of a treatment or somebody else's support.
Are you going to get any help with this addiction? Any support of any kind?
No, I'm not asking for any.
You're talking a little bit the way that we talk. You won't be going to meetings, and you draw on your own personal values, probably values that you've known about since you were a little boy.
Mm-hmm.
About right and wrong.
Yeah.
About your responsibility and all that.
Yeah.
So to answer or to respond, I know what you mean. In the system, that is exactly the way that it looks. I'm a clinical social worker. I worked with addicted people for many years from that end of it. And it does look pretty hopeless for people who reject the administrations of professional people and recovery groups. But the majority of people who have addictions actually do get it on their own. They recover by themselves, and AA, just in about less than a year ago, acknowledged that of all the successful recoveries that occur, 60% of them occur outside of AA without groups, without counseling, without rehabs or treatment. They just get fed up with being a drunk, and they crack the whip upon themselves, or this part of themselves, at least, that loves to drink, and they make a commitment, a personal, moral kind of commitment, that I will never drink again. I don't care what's going to happen. I will never do that again. Mm-hmm. And they find within themselves something that's supposed to be absent in addicted people, but it's there, we think, in a good number of people.
Yeah, I'd say there's nothing wrong with you that you're still stuck in the problem, but there's something wrong with the services that you've gotten for the last 17 years that nobody ever explained to you how people actually kick addictions. In fact, they probably stopped you from doing it. But supposing some person just says, well, you know, I'm never going to do that again. I don't care what happens, I'm never going to use again, and I'm not going to change my mind. So we're looking for people in this new agency we're willing to just say, I will never drink or use, no matter how bad life gets, no matter how much my AIDS hurts, no matter how much people don't love me, no matter where I have to sleep at night, I'll never use again. What part of never don't we understand? Yeah, that's the bottom line of it. And start being normal.
And how do I go about doing that?
Now, we got some information. We don't know much about treatment, but we have some information for you about how people really recover on their own, like you're starting out to do, and is based upon the people who have actually succeeded on their own, outside of groups, outside of treatment. Rational recovery is self-recovery. We believe in you and your ability. We don't think there's any help for you.
It just basically comes down to just mindset.
Yes, you know, just it's a decision.
Exactly.
It's a decision.
Question from... Yeah. Our new director of CSAS.
Yeah. Yes, as a clinical psychologist that has done a lot of practice with individuals who have been labeled or have labeled themselves addicted, and both clinical and research experience, how would you respond to the criticism that, basically, your approach is flying at the face of a lot of the research that has been conducted by Stanford and Harvard and a lot of these universities that have talked and actually most recently talked about addiction as being a chronic illness that needs to be managed as such, and that the criticism of systems of treatment that actually don't work is because we've actually looked at addiction not so much as an episodic illness, but have failed to really see it as a chronic long-term illness such as diabetes. That when the second that somebody, for example, would stop taking their insulin with diabetes, of course you would have a relapse. And so with substance abuse, similarly, if you look at it as a chronic long-term illness, the minute that you remove treatment and that you remove any kind of episodic treatment, that you would eventually would have a relapse because essentially it is a chronic long-term illness where the individual, where the individual actually is not able to control themselves, very similarly to not being able to control the fact that they would have either cancer or diabetes, and so therefore has got to really begin to think of their illness as a long-term illness. But the other thing is that your title is New Rational Recovery Initiative, which implies that anybody who doesn't follow this might be irrational. Isn't it blaming the victim, and isn't it some of what the field of addiction has really fought for decades to not do? So my question is, how would you respond to the criticism that would say that you're basically flying against the face of all the technology and research that talks about addiction as being a long-term?
Well, I think I hear the concerns. These are concerns based upon scientific discourse, research and discourse. And that's all well and good. This is what helps public policy get formed. This is what helps to justify programs. I think it's all fine. That kind of information, though, very often does not make a dent in the problem that exists in the streets and in people's homes. And what we're trying very, very, very much to accomplish is to say, well, yeah, that's all good and that's interesting, and a lot of, I think, wise programming can come from that. But ought we not to go and make sure that all of the people that we are serving here can really benefit from these well substantiated, see, these are scientific substantiations or rationales for the programs. What about giving people an opportunity to opt out of these scientifically founded programs and say, well, yeah, I would like to just simply say that until there's a blood test that shows that I am an alcoholic, that I have this disease, or until there's some evidence, a laboratory protocol that shows that I am an alcoholic who cannot control my bodily behavior, that I will take responsibility for my conduct.
Well, certainly you must be familiar with some of the recent genetic research that shows that alcoholics and drug addicts do have a genetic predisposition, that there is actually a gene that can be identified for those individuals that have a long history of alcoholism and have relatives that have had a history of alcoholism, that now there is a genetic component that can be...
Well, now this is being told to people by agencies here as if it's fact that there really is disease, and I have a trouble with that, because these studies, the genetic studies, are inferential. This is pure inferential, to say, well, look, the family did this and all that, so therefore, let's say that there's a disease there, somewhere up here, or somewhere spiritual, neurological, or somewhere in the liver, who knows. Let's say there's a disease in there, we'll call it alcoholism, and that's what you're suffering from, and the only treatment is what we offer here. Why don't we just say, well, why don't we give informed consent and let people know that this is a hotly debated issue? in the field. You're saying something. I don't know if this is the place for an open debate on it, because we're really looking at a public policy issue more than a scientific this discussion here. But I think to make latitude and say, yes, these are all, you can think of it that way. You can think about it as a disease, but a lot of people, by not thinking about a disease, will say, look, if it's not a disease, if I'm not sick, then I'm just stupid, so I'm going to stop doing this. I'm going to stop drinking. So a lot of people will say, well, if you haven't done it by now, that proves that you can't. And we're saying, no, if you haven't quit by now, what that means is that you need to learn how to quit. How do people really quit? It's not by saying that you have a disease. It's by saying, I have the ability. I believe in myself. Even though my shrink doesn't, my doctor doesn't, all these other people don't, I believe in myself. And I will never drink again, Your Honor. That's the way we do it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. And we want to get to Your Honor. We do want to get to Your Honor. Believe me.
You have a number of people out there who have questions.
Good.
My name is Artis Jerome. I'm a member of the public. You talked about AVR, I believe. Would you please elaborate on that? Just walk me through it.
Okay.
I would come to you as a client. I would pay you. I would do what? I would. How long is your
We want
program?
To provide no services. See, what we're proposing is an agency that would not provide counseling or treatment. It would provide information. It would be written, it would be on a computer monitor. It can be explained in a didactic teaching way, but we want to get away from the idea that there is a treatment or a therapy that gets at hidden reasons for addiction. We say the sole cause of your addiction is a voice in your head that says, do it. And when you learn to recognize that that voice is not you, but your body talking to you, you're recovered. You're done. It can happen in a day. And that's exactly how people pop out of addictions that have been doing so for thousands of years. The problem is that we say, well, if you haven't quit by now, that proves you can't. You've got this hypothetical disease, and you have to join a group and do these treatments. We're saying, no, let's teach people about the voice in the head that says drink. And when we do that, AVRT starts out by saying, well, there's really two of you. If you're an addicted person, there's two of you sitting there in your chair. One of you wants to quit because you know it's bad for you, but the other of you wants to keep doing this for the rest of your life, forever. You're profoundly conflicted about the use of the drug. So when we tell people that they have a disease that makes them powerless, we actually are inadvertently fortifying the addictive voice. It makes people think, well, there's nothing that I can do. I can't quit. Bill W. says you should not swear off. We all try to swear off, and that doesn't work.
Do you think that people ever just quit?
You don't quit. You stop.
Yeah, you didn't use today. Are you ever going to use again? That's, in my opinion, I'm going to give you an opinion, is that expression like that, that's the problem. You don't know.
I don't know.
What we're saying is, no, it's very important that you swear off, not one day at a time, but from now until you're dead. Never. I will never, ever do this again. When very severely addicted people do this, they get better very quickly, and even after multiple admissions to very good, well-staffed and well-thought-out treatment programs, they keep coming back and finally get better this way. It happens all the time.
It's a decision that a person makes, a moral decision, and it's a commitment to themselves.
We all have within ourselves this ability to cease and desist from the use. Yeah, all is all inside of us.
Okay, yes, I see what you're saying.
And instead of saying we have a disease that makes us powerless over the desire to go get high,
right,
that in my case, these are my hands. My addiction does not move my hands. I do.
Right.
That I am in control.
Right, I agree.
And the worst thing that I could possibly think is that I'm powerless over the operation of my hands and my feet. Right. Some people do recover.
Some people do.
How do they do it?
Not many. I don't know.
Recovery by making a decision to never ever use again, and then they figure out very quickly in just a matter of day or two how to stick with that decision forever, and they stick to it, and then pretty soon they get used to being without it, and they start to do a little better as the days go by, and pretty soon they're better. And at that point they walk away from the addiction and they opt out of the addiction identity.
My question is, I come to this place you're going to create?
Yes.
And I'm going to do it for free one day?
A lot of people do that. The paradigm that is current is that this is a process of self-improvement. You become more honest and more, you do moral inventories and all of these things, and gradually things happen through self-improvement. And what we do in AVRT say, no, it's not a process. This is something, it's an event that happens. It's something that we force to happen, and we make a decision. And at that time, we become recovered. One day, we are addicted. The next day, we are recovered.
I've got a sea of hands.
I just have a couple statements, really.
Could you please give your names?
My name is Steve Anderson, and I'm a member of the public. I am a former addict, and I also work for a drug treatment program here in the city.
Yeah.
So I have a lot of different perspectives on this whole thing. What I think, I wanted to say real quickly that when I saw this flyer, I thought, wow, this is how I recovered. I just quit using one day, and I didn't go to AA meetings or nothing like that. When I bring it up to people, they say, oh, well, you must not have been very addicted.
Yeah, no, shame.
They sort of minimize my experience, which is sort of irritating, because I have to prove how addicted I really was, dang it.
But I was one of the worst drunkards in the history of the world. I believe it. I mean, really ugly, ugly, stinky, ugly, stinky, mean, and the whole bit. And that was that way for a long time. And I destroyed a part of my family's life. You can't undo what you do. We can live down our stupidity and our immorality by not ever drinking. And this is the natural refraction of addiction, that we do this, we finally, well, you could say we grow up maybe, we do something, but we cease and desist. And then that becomes the watershed event in life, is this decision that you and a lot of people in this room, we think that there are more of us than there are in AA, to tell you quite frankly. AA is acknowledging it. Most people just get fed up with it and stop. And this is a skill that can be taught, and it's called AVRT, Addictive Voice Recognition Technique. It's an indigenous.
A couple other things.
Yes.
What excites me about this is that there are a group of people, having worked in a treatment for many, many years, there are a group of people that we're not reaching. A third of the people that go through my program come back again. I don't know if it's going to be, what's going to be the key to keep them. But I'm not ready to say no to anything yet. Mm-hmm. I'm going to keep throwing things at them, and I'm excited about this as an opportunity of one other idea to throw their way.
Yeah, I want to pay honest respect to the objections that I'm feeling and getting here, because this is a tough paradigm. This is a difficult paradigm to catch on to. Yes. It is fundamentally different than mainstream thinking altogether. And when we start saying these things out loud and putting them in print, people go, oh my God, what are you talking about? If these people could have quit, they would have done it. They wouldn't have done this on purpose to themselves.
Have you ever heard of rational recovery?
There's nothing rational about recovery.
Rational recovery has been around for about 20 years. Okay. And very few people, not enough people, know about it. A lot of professional people know about it, but for some reason they don't tell enough people about it. And they'd rather see people come to their to the groups and their treatment centers than to just simply cease and desist from their addictions. Okay, now you have. We are the other guys on the across the street from AA nationwide. What AA says, we say it ain't so. They say you're powerless, we say no, no. They say it's a lifelong process, one meeting at a time. We say, no, it happens all at once. It's in a big decision that you'll never, ever use again under any circumstances.
So what we're saying is that there is an untapped resource in our clients. In each caseload, you might have a caseload that is this thick, and over here, there's a resource in here of people who may do better by not serving them, by not counseling, by not, and simply saying, well, here, I believe in your ability to do this by yourself. And I want you to talk to the rational recovery people, or if you've heard about rational recovery, say, I frankly doubt your ability to do this on your own. And when you talk to those idiots down at rational recovery, come back here and we'll be here for you. However you want to do it, but at least let the people know that there is a group of people who believe in you. That we believe in people's ability to defeat addiction to alcohol, heroin, crack, cocaine. These are substances that are quit all the time. And there is a myth that certain things are unbeatable, that once you've been to the high point of this drug, there's no turning back. Well, that's not true.
You got more questions, too.
Yeah.
One that I want to bring up is, as you know, by the 2003 June, we will actually be implementing and holding providers accountable for the harm reduction policy. And so that's, when you really think about it, that's not that far into the future. It's actually less than a year from now. And so we are trying to fall back from that date and really figure out what it is that we have to do to make sure that providers are able to understand what harm reduction is going to mean for example, abstinence-based models and begin to outline how we can all kind of really participate with the same mission regardless of what the purpose of the organization is, meaning, you know, whether it's a abstinence model or not. So the movement is actually taken on more of a national scope.
As an example, would a program that suggests a compassionate relapse policy fall under the blanket of harm reduction?
Yes. And even abstinent models would fall under harm reduction if they can really kind of identify the mission of abstinence within the scope of harm reduction, meaning that if they really feel that in their mission that somebody who, for example, relapses is not welcome back into the program, maybe for 24 hours or whatever, but they have a protocol to be able to either refer the individual to a program that would be able to take them or have some kind of set standard of following through.
I think that answers my next question, was that does a program that has a particular outline that states, you know, maybe this just isn't for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't seem to be able to wrap your mind around what we're telling you, mm-hmm. or what we're teaching you. So as long as that place were to have good referral connections to the industry at large, then that would be fine.
Exactly. And that's what we want. We're not going to force, you know, every provider to have a harm reduction policy per se, but to really understand that within their organization, they're going to be impacted by harm reduction as a whole, because the city and county will make sure that that policy is adopted by everybody. So every provider has to answer the question for themselves, and
right.
It may mean a different thing for different individuals. And I think to that extent, we really need to provide some leadership in terms of figuring out exactly what harm reduction might mean given different scenarios and different providers. So, you know, that's something that we'll be working toward. And the idea behind harm reduction really is to meet the client where they're at and to be more client-focused and, you know, kind of reduce some of the more judgmental aspects of treatment that often get encountered.
My name is Michael Kelly. I'm a harm reduction advocate for the community.
Yeah.
I just have a couple grave concerns. It's a lifelong process becoming a fiend or a drunk, and I'm really scared to think that somebody could actually do that in the afternoon by simply saying, you know, I give up, I want to change. I believe in empowerment, but I also believe in the power of a parole officer or a recovery house or that whole kind of thing. I also believe in the baggage that comes with sexual trauma, violence, the things that lead people to addiction. My question is, what is exactly a normal abstinent person anyhow that you're talking about on this slide?
It's a person who had trouble, big troubles with alcohol and drugs, and no longer does that. They're up and down every street, about every 8 or 10. In other words, they're people who are engaged in life, and they've left an addiction behind them. Like all these guys came back from Vietnam, heavy opiate users, they left it behind. It was no longer, it didn't fit their life. So
there's a lot of soldiers that all of a sudden said, hey, I'm okay, I'm giving up heroin.
Yeah, and they jonesed. I'm not saying they didn't jones. I'm not saying they didn't have a lot of euphoric recall and all that.
So where is this information obtainable about Vietnam vets using rational recovery all of a sudden give up everything and becoming a normal?
Well, what I'm reporting on is the fact that the vets did come back addicted and just simply laid the needle down and walked away from it. The vast majority, like 90% of them.
Now that's horse hockey.
That's common knowledge, actually. That's not untrue. The number that they assessed, the Army assessed as being addicted or dependent upon heroin, there was a small percentage of them only that went into the clinics and methadone maintenance.
Those were the lifelong addicts, though, not the people that picked up over
there. Oh, yes.
No, so there are some lifelong addicts. Well, nobody's lifelong, but you know, they start out young and they keep doing it. And some of those people finally stop doing it. This is not unheard of. It's not even all that uncommon. But we're not saying that everybody should be expected to do this. What we're saying is that this is an option that needs to be available to any addicted person, that they drop the needle and say, there, that is the end of it. And it's not going to just be without informed my informed decision. I want the information on how people do quit, not how they get treatment and counseling and all that, but how do people really do it? I know there are people who do quit these addictions. How do they do it? Well, that's what we have done, is that we have come up with a kind of a synthesis of the common thread of success and laid it out for people to learn. And very often, people come back and say, well, in a very short time, my long-standing addiction is over.
My name is Brenda Goldhammer, and speaking for the public. I came here actually with a really open mind because I've been working with chaotic active users for a really long time, probably since about 1989, and from a harm reduction-based model. So I was really excited to learn about sort of a new approach, especially because I do see, as you call them, frequent flyers. I see people in and out of the treatment system, and certainly I'm looking towards any idea of where to direct individuals that really feel like they've failed. And I guess there's a couple concerns that I have, and for someone to be able to say to themselves, you know, I can do this, I can stop drinking, or I can stop using drugs, and I think this tags along with the previous gentleman's question. If someone isn't able to, even though they make the statement and they really believe it in their heart, and I'll tell you, my background's also working in the state prison system, teaching health education and harm reduction to individuals inside. And every individual in that classroom says to me, I don't want to come back here. I don't want to do drugs again. I don't want to be here again, because I know what will happen. I know how I get here. And they leave with the best of intentions. They don't want to come back, and they don't want to see me again. And you know what? They do. They do come back. And the shame and the guilt and how crushed these individuals feel, I fear for this type of program that would feed into that belief system that I am a failure because I don't have the willpower to do it.
Okay, so
and
do you
I'm
have
just
a
really
question?
Wondering how your program really addresses the feelings of failure that a lot of our clients feel.
Well, because we're afraid to fail does not mean that we should not try. It's very important to take risks in this lifetime. But we get concerned because it seems that if anyone is to stand up and walk away from an addiction, it would cast a shadow on those who do not. And that's a problem that I think that you're describing here, is that some people may feel uncomfortable and feel like a failure if others were to stand up and say, I will never do that again, as if that means something to the people who don't. So this is why the opt-out is needed, is to get people out of the system so that a homogeneous group like harm reduction, people who have every intention of continuing to use.
That's not what harm reduction is about, Mr. Trimpey.
Well, there's an acknowledgement.
Exactly where people are at today.
Yeah, they're going to continue.
It's
expected. Yeah, it's
so
expected
with
that
all
they will.
Respect, you're not correct.
So what we want to do is to allow people to opt out of that if they want to do that, and not to necessarily cast a shadow on people left behind. They
not,
just simply
I'm
do that.
I'm suggesting for the individual themselves.
Exactly.
I know
what we're saying.
When I decide that I, you know, don't want to do something, and then I do it again, and even though I really didn't want to do it, smoking, doing drugs, whatever, if I use again something that I don't intend to use, I feel crappy about myself for doing
that's
that.
Addiction.
And I'm wondering, and that's addiction. And I'm wondering how your program deals with the shame and guilt that individuals feel, like I feel when I relapse, when I don't succeed.
Well,
when it was my best intention, I didn't want to
see,
do
see, the
this.
Shame, speaking for myself, it was because of my shame and revulsion at myself and what I had been doing that I finally took action, finally. And it's the reason, see, when we treat these emotions of shame and guilt and mitigate that, we're taking away the reason that people have to quit.
So your people would come together and talk about it? They would come in a group
no,
form and
no,
talk
they
about
would
the
come,
guilt and the shame
no,
about
no, no, no,
the
no, no,
one
no, no,
treat?
No, 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 no,
well,
no, 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 they don't do that. We don't do problems. She's asking, do we get together and commiserate about guilt? Of course not. People have it. When they quit their addictions, they have much less to feel guilty about.
Your name, please?
Yes, my name is Shondi Anderson.
Okay.
And I am a member of the public, and also I am a former addict and someone who works in the field. That I was a part of 12-step for several years. And I think it's important that we have a community of people that we can talk to and get support from. I think it's important that if we choose to, we do have counseling available to us.
Was there some, that I don't know if I suggested that people be denied access to recovery groups and treatment. That is not on our agenda by any means.
Counseling.
What we're saying is that keep on. This is a very well put together social service system, addiction service system here. We have no concerns. All we're saying is that when it gets to a certain point, though, people need an ability to opt out and say, look, I don't get this. I want to do it on my own.
Right.
I don't want to be required to affiliate with a recovery group in order to hold my job or all these things.
I don't think that it has to be a do-it-alone kind of thing.
When people want that, but people need an option to say, you know, I want to go it alone. I have a family, and I look to the family as where I want to be in the evenings, where I get my support,
so you're getting
and all
support
that.
From the family. You're not
or I'm a loner. I like my hotel room. I watch television. I collect stamps, and that's what I want to do alone. And I'm not going to drink in my solitary room.
One of the things that I discovered for myself before I'd ever heard of rational recovery was that step one was very troubling for me. Believing that I was powerless to change that about myself was not helping me,
mm-hmm.
that I needed to feel empowered.
Yeah.
So for that reason, I like what you have to say.
It is a very healthy thing that you're suggesting offering options, because that was one of the worst things I experienced in my early recovery, was realizing that there was only one option for me.
Yeah.
I could either do 12-step, or they told me I was going to be a failure. If I didn't do 12-step, that was it for me.
This is
one
aspect. Yeah.
Is a good thing.
This is an aspect I think that needs to be reckoned with. I don't want to get terribly taken up with some of these problems that you're starting to identify, but there are problems like that.
Yeah.
You got more questions, too. Ms. Davis over here has been waiting a long time.
Oh. What I am is an advocate for homelessness and now substance abuse, because the clients that I just went out and worked with for 2 months and got each in recovery, okay, one is successful, the girlfriend, the guy is not. I so buy into what you're saying. My interpretation of rational recovery, what you're saying is that the people are saying, I'm ready.
Yeah.
And maybe they're not ready for this other process that's out there. Sam was so ready. To begin with, he lost his place. He's homeless. And that's what started me on the track of, oh my gosh, it's too bad you're out there. What can I do? This is a man who had not drank for 10 years. I find this out later. So he was out there,
mm-hmm.
and he was only out there maybe half a week. And he didn't have resources, he didn't have information about resources, he just didn't know. What I found out was that he had begun drinking. So he went back to what he had fought and beat 10 years ago because of his circumstances. The thing is, it's not that he's an alcoholic, it's that he's homeless, and he's drinking again because he's out there. He actually put it by himself. He went to recovery, I guess where you walk in and walk out of. He went to one of those groups for maybe 2 months or so, and the rest was on him for 10 years.
Does he know about rational recovery yet?
No, he doesn't, because I'm here, he will, okay?
Good. Can he read?
He's an intelligent man.
Good,
so he
then this would be helpful, because this is available in print, and it can be learned in a very short time. It's written with the addicted person in mind,
okay,
for the addicted person.
You're like our last hope. Because
let me interrupt just for a second. This is what we hear about 8 times a day. You are our last hope. You're the last house on the block. We've been through the system. And this is why Lois and I we very much want to get this into the system, so that people just simply know that we're here. And they'll look it up on their own. They'll find out about it. They'll make use of it. And avoid this, what he's going through, this endless cycle of detox, treatment, all this,
yes,
the groups, and then quitting the groups, and then relapse, and all this thing.
I've got a sea of hands.
I'm Keith Fowler, I'm the chair of the public policy,
right.
And a couple concerns that have just come up for me professionally thinking and reading your book. Our concerns for ancillary services for outside support. The director of a drug treatment program, 60 to 70% of our clients have an Access 1 mental health diagnosis, and I would have significant concerns about somebody taking on AVRT and then dropping out of the system, if you will, where they wouldn't be hooked up.
Okay, I'm right on this.
Maybe losing contact with the therapist and the psychiatrist, because they would somehow consider that.
I have to lunge into this. I was with San Joaquin County Mental Health for 10 years, and I know very deeply the nature of psychiatric problems. And in no way would we even slightly discourage psychiatric care, because these are real problems that just require medical assistance. So we want to be able to separate the problems, say, I think away from the system, we can say, well, you call yourself a dual diagnosis, but we know there's only one, because this is not a diagnosis, this is bad action on your part. Are you going to do it anymore, or aren't you? That's the way we want to talk about it, not dual diagnosis. If the system wants to bill on two diagnoses, that's the system's business.
Okay. Yeah. Following up on that, in regards to AVRT and that approach, I couldn't help but be impressed by it does seem to have some cognitive behavioral replacement techniques.
That's getting pretty deep now. What is this?
It seems to have a fairly cognitive behavioral approach to it, with regard to feelings that may come up, and then being able to retrain your thought patterns about not choosing not to use or whatever when those feelings come up, recognizing that it seems like it's fairly cognitive behavioral in nature. So I'm wondering, from that perspective, what your thoughts would be about it being beneficial for somebody with a thought disorder who has fairly clear distortions of perceptions and thoughts.
If you're talking about people who hear voices,
mm-hmm.
would be astute mm-hmm. for this because it's called addictive voice recognition. They recognize voices, and the first thing you ask them when they come into your office, are you hearing the voices? And with AVRT, you'll be saying, now, is there any voice in there that's telling you you should drink? And they'll say, yeah, that's voice number three. We'll say, watch out for that one. That's your enemy. The rest of them are just there. The medications will help with those. But there's no way to medicate the addictive voice. That's the voice of pleasure. We can't medicate that out of existence because that's your pleasure drive. So we just want to help people who are who have bona fide psychiatric problems to get the very best psychiatric care. And we think that it's an error to put mentally disordered people into a rather confusing social milieu, which you have to admit the recovery group is.
One of my last questions. So what would be your approach to dealing with relapse, the actual event or multiple events of relapse, whether that's episodic or longer term?
Now, a relapse, when people call, Lois usually answers the telephone, and they call and say, I had a relapse. And she says, oh, you had a drink? I say, yeah. There's a big difference between having a relapse and having a drink. Relapse is what you have in the clinic, a drink is what you did at home. See, that was a big difference. And what we're saying is that these are not relapses, these are drinks. Why did you drink? I wanted to feel the effect of it. I wanted to feel that sensate signature. I wanted it. That's
You're
why I did it.
You're kind of changing the lingo. Yeah,
yeah, we want people to take personal responsibility. I drank. I didn't have a relapse. I drank. Why did I drink? Because I wanted to.
You don't mean the same way.
So my question to you would be as to which individuals for whom an abstinence-based program would be successful are to choose to opt out of the system.
Oh, okay.
And
now, this is one of the reasons, you know, the way it's set up now is that we reach your clientele through the back door. We're doing it through the internet. We send out mailings once in a while. We sell books. We have our telephone line. People get the telephone. They call us. And they aren't getting it from the people, the public agencies that are tax-funded to provide this kind of information. So what we want is to create an office here, an actual physical place with a desk and a person to do this, to screen. In other words, for people to be informed, there is now a place to go. If you don't like these meetings, if you don't think you can be helped by treatment, you can go over here and check out this place, and then we will screen.
Are you going to use any more drugs in this lifetime? You want to leave the option open then to continue using?
Yeah, well, the option is always there.
And maybe some people will say, you know, it sounds to me like you don't really want to quit for good. It sounds to me like you really want to leave the door open for future use. And at that point we say, well, keep on doing what you're doing. We will not accept you for services here. You have to qualify, and it's a subjective thing, like many diagnostic procedures are. It would be a conclusion that we would reach that here's a person that looks like a reasonable bet to learn the means to abstain and to remain abstinent. So, in other words, we're in a way leaving it partly up to the clients to self-select and then to have some prevention of abuse of the system by someone who would make some judgments, some clinical judgments about who can and who cannot benefit from it.
Would not regard Rational Recovery Initiative as another service provider?
But not the services. It would be an actual place with the person, say like Brian or myself or somebody. We don't want to provide more treatment. That's what they're trying to. Many people they've been through it so many times, they don't want to hear it anymore, and they do have the capacity to abstain. Those are the people that we want to get out of the system.
We're coming to San Francisco. We're trying to persuade the city and the county and some other people to create an agency that doesn't provide any services, if you believe them. That's kind of a silly thing. A program for people who've been through the system over and over and over again, they still don't have their act together and probably never will get their act together unless they have a new way to look at it.
Right.
And that's what we are aiming
for. So you're
for.
Presenting a new way of looking at it,
yeah,
where it might give me a chance to free
to
myself.
Take the responsibility is help people who took the full responsibility for recovery, which means abstinence. It would take those people and help them to leave the identity of being an addict. Yeah. We want to be work with people like you who are saying, I don't want any services. I just want an equal opportunity to get housing, to get a job so I can get the system off my back.
Yeah.
And
sure.
The system, we hope they want you off their back, but we're not so sure sometimes.
Well, you just opened a big political can of worms right there.
We want to get you divorced from the system.
Thank you.
So you're in. So you're independent.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Whoa.
You got more questions too.
Yeah.
Most of us that have been working in recovery for a while have been inculcated with the message that, you know, some things work for some people some of the time. So I don't have any problem with the approach in the sense that there may be a market of people out there that fit into your scheme. But two very quick questions, both of them sort of related. That at the University of Pennsylvania and at Berkeley University and Stanford and some of the other schools, in doing brain imaging techniques and through brain scanning, they can watch the actual brain change when drugs and alcohol are ingested.
Yeah.
One of which is that the neurotransmitters become absolutely depleted in some cases.
Yeah. This PET scan research that's going on, if you take the same machinery, the same hardware, and just move the diodes a little bit around, and then at lunchtime, do this at lunchtime and put a hamburger in front of the person's visual field or whatever, you'll get the same light up situation. This is not very sophisticated kind of research. It is very impressive to show it on TV. Alan Leshner said, oh look, see the disease, see how the brain lights up. That proves it's a disease. There's no such thing. If you have a sexual object dance in front of a subject who's wired like that, you'll see other parts of the brain dancing around. So I think it's a real stretch to really get serious about this hypothetical disease model that's getting ever more elaborate in its attempt to justify itself.
So the question is, how do you address that aspect of it? And tied to that is that the proponents of Proposition 36 and all of the other agenda that is trying to move from a legal model, addiction and substance abuse, from a legal model to a medical model, have invested a whole lot in substantiating the medical model to take it out of the legal realm.
Yeah.
How do you address that if you are saying that the person can make up their mind? Now it's a totally legal question because now you're talking about a moral decision that the person can make or not make.
Yes.
How do you address?
That's a systems problem. We let them worry about that. We really have no concern that the system has worked itself into an untenable position of saying, you are responsible, here's the cuffs, you're going to jail, and then you get out of your cell and you go to a meeting and they say, well, you were powerless to do anything else. So you're saying you're responsible, but you're not. So that's the system's problem. That's not our problem.
There's 2 million people locked up in America right now.
I know.
It's our problem.
Right. It's a system's problem. And what we want to do is give people the freedom to obey the law. And if drugs are illegal, for them to be able to say, I will never do that again, and to have some weight attached to that.
Just quickly, I didn't hear the part about urine tests. If people are on probation and parole, how would your agency handle that? Or
we would simply tell our people, you owe tests. You have a debt. Whatever the system asks of you in the way of testing, you owe it. So pay up, get your tests, get them done,
or we won't work with you. If you don't play ball with the system that way, then we won't play ball with you either.
Have you done any outcomes from the services that you provide? And within that, do you also have a breakdown of outcomes in terms of culture and gender?
Okay, are you talking about abstinent outcome?
I would be interested in all of the whatever database you were collecting.
Well, I mean, are we talking about, are we using abstinent outcome?
Sure, I'd be interested in knowing anything that you're looking to.
Okay, the reason I'm getting picky on that is because this is a missing link in public research. None of your programs have abstinent outcome reported. It's not there. That's why we do abstinent outcome research, and the numbers are quite good. AA is already fessed up or admitted that 60% of the people who recover from addictions, significant addictions, do it without the ministrations of professionals or sponsors or anybody. That's Valiant, George Valiant, the premier researcher, has laid it on the line. He said, this is the way it is. People are getting better more on their own than they are in AA. AVRT is how we say they are doing it. The numbers that we collect are, we have our own numbers, 65% on an 18-month interval, no correction for gender or other demographic data. It's just a group that we saw came through our AVRT instruction.
18-month
period, 65% had no use whatsoever. Another group had a little bit of use but had capitulated and were steady on their own. No follow-up whatsoever, no groups, no counseling, no nothing for that group. The other research was done and is found in the American Journal of Substance Abuse, done by New York University Medical School, Mark Gallanter, and got a 74% abstinence rate. The thing that we're impressed with, though, is that what would you compare our numbers to? AA, as you know, has about a 2% abstinent outcome at a 5-year interval. After you get all the newcomers coming in, 95% of them are just gone the first year, unless they're forced to remain. And after 5 years, that's 5% remaining, half of those are abstinent. So it's a very tiny abstinent outcome from conventional addiction treatment services. The self-recovery data is just overwhelmingly showing that self-recovery is more common, more cost-effective than facilitated recovery of any kind. So we're not we want psychiatric care to stay in place. We want the law to be obeyed and enforced and corrections to be full. What we want to do is to make it possible for some people to abstain from alcohol and drugs. That's the only thing that we have any immediate concern with. And we know, we're not just guessing, we know that people very often do much better when they are not attending recovery groups, they're not seeing shrinks, they're not going to rehabs, they're simply doing this as a matter of principle, a personal principle. I never do this, I never do that.
Brian? Well, yeah, because there's a good deal of concern about rational recovery as outlined, opt-out initiative, dealing with people that may want to leave the treatment industry behind, and that's quite a big step for folks. So now this is just as a public member. You know, sure, I'm a board member, but you know, I left 12 steps after 3 years, 3+ years. I ended my relationship with my sponsor, which was the hardest, if not the most, still to this day, sticky, gooey, emotional thing in my life, considering that I told this person everything about me. This person was there all the time. I was on that phone constantly, you know, reviving my decision not to use for today and help me to stay sober today. And oh my God, I'm about to use today. Help me through this today. And it kept going on like that. And I was reading a Grapevine article from March 2002. And I just real quick will point this out. And this is why I left AA. and NA. In sobriety, I discovered my passion for exploring the wilderness. This guy's going on a camping trip. At 21 months sober, I accepted a summer job working at the Wilderness Expedition Guide in Maine, New Hampshire, and in New Hampshire. Before departing, I was very scared. Constantly, I felt this. I didn't know if I could stay sober because I wouldn't be able to use the many tools that were keeping me sober. No frequent meetings, no telephone calls. He's out in the wilderness, and there's, you know, these camp things. Home group, service position, active sponsorship. I worried that I can end up restless, irritable, and discontent. Thus, now I'm adding this, and use. That was the anxiety I lived with day in and day out in my life, feeling the feelings that I feel, having the issues in life come up and stuff, and I was afraid, and I was biting the bullet, and I was sweating bullets, and I was successful, yet I was still ambivalent in a very strange sense, because the support around me told me, or didn't tell me, Brian, just quit for good. Be done with it. That was intuitively what I sought, and that's what I did. I decided never to use, and it was after I found your book in the library, the only one there, by the way, that kicked it into that one extra kick that just sent me right over the, you know, the end of my addiction. So where I fully recovered. I'm not addicted because I'll never use. I'm not addicted because I have no desire to use. And even if I did want to use, I wouldn't do it. Even if I did have a, which I don't, you know.
And Brian speaks the truth. He would be called in denial. And there's this underlying theme that says, yeah, let's see, it's not over till it's over, buddy. And I've heard that for many years. But it's he's better. Yeah. I'm better, and it's a very ordinary thing.
But everybody started in the 12-step foundation.
It's the status quo.
And that's why you're able to leap to where you are today. But everybody started at 12-step. Most of everybody.
Can I?
It's okay. It's okay. Can I stay open-minded.